the ever living, he is the first. He's the owner of mercy. He sent his messengers to warn his creatures of the great dangers of worship.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله الملك الحق المبين، وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله المبعوث رحمة للعالمين. We begin in the name of Allah, the Most Merciful. All praise and glory belongs to Allah, Lord of the Worlds. Indeed, Allah is deserving of the best of thanks and the most beautiful of praises. And we testify that no one is worthy of worship but Allah alone, without any partners, the true supreme king. And that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was his servant and his messenger, whom he sent as a mercy to the worlds. We welcome everyone back to The Prince of Piety, Lessons from the Story of Musa alayhi salam, as told to us in Surah Al-Qasas. We move on to another ayah. Allah Azza wa Jal says, فَسَقَى لَهُمَا. So he watered for them. He watered for them their flocks. ثُمَّ تَوَلَّى إِلَى الظِّلِّ فَقَالَ رَبِّي إِنِّي لِمَا أَنزَلْتَ إِلَيَّ مِنْ خَيْرٍ فَقِيرٍ. And then he turned to the shade. He went and sought the shade of a tree. And he said, Oh my Lord, I am for whatever good you send down to me in need. Of course, first of all, notice that he was a man that was away from home. And his shoes had ripped, we mentioned. And that was the only thing he had. No luggage or otherwise. And he was homeless. And he was afraid. And despite all that, he did not ask for compensation. And this is the ideal state. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us, when there comes to you wealth from Allah without it costing your self-respect, your dignity, then accept it. Meaning, ideally, especially when you do a good deed, you don't ask for compensation. If it comes your way, that's different, as it will come his way in a minute. But he did not ask for it. He did not ask for compensation, and as some of the shuyukh say, nor did he strike a conversation. Many of us will only help the opposite gender when there is a personal interest involved, and that usually arises right after we help. But Musa alayhi salatu wasalam did it and walked away. He helped them. Your need is finished, he walked. He did not tell them, what is your name? My name is so-and-so. What is your story? This is my story. What is your need now? Water, here is the water. And he went off to the shade, and he preferred to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he said, Rabbi, my master. Fifth time, remember? Fifth time he's saying Rabbi so far. إِنِّي لِمَا أَنزَلْتَ إِلَيَّ مِنْ خَيْرٍ فَقِيرٍ. I am in a dire need for whatever good you can send down to me. This awesome wording of this dua teaches us so many things. The first is that he actually admitted his need. And you can say Allah Azza already knows his need, so why is he telling Allah his need? Some people have this misconception, even if they don't admit it. They are lazy with dua because Allah knows what I'm going through. Surely He does. But you admitting your need is you saying, Oh Allah, I cannot get any help for this from anyone but you. You admitting that you have a need and no one but Allah can help you with that need. This is the first thing. The second thing is that He said, Oh Allah, I am in a dire need of whatever good you can send to me. And this is of the intelligence of the wise, that when you ask Allah to grant you from the good that He knows. For indeed, especially with worldly matters, only He knows where the good lies. The religious matters are all good, in this world and the next. But when it comes to dunya, and he was having a dunya dilemma right now, right? He was hungry, and he was homeless, and he was shoeless and the like. Oh Allah, send me the good. Many times we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something, and we don't realize that it could harm us in effect. So we say, Oh Allah, if this is good for me, then grant it to me. Just as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say in that beautiful hadith of Ammar radiallahu ta'ala, narrated Sunan Nasa'i and others, Ahmad narrated as well in Khuzaymah, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught them a dua that begins by saying, Allahumma bi'ilmika al-ghayb. Oh Allah, by your knowledge of the unseen, you know the aftermath of things. Oh Allah, by your knowledge of the unseen, wa qudratika al-khalq, and by your ability upon the creation, ahyini ma alimta al-hayata khayran li. Give me life so long as you know that life is good for me. وَتَوَفَّنِي إِذَا عَلِمْتَ الْوَفَاةَ خَيْرًا لِي. And put me to death when you know that death is better for me. So even life and death, we don't know what is good in that. Sometimes a person living longer will be better. Sometimes it's even more harmful, for it will increase his black scrolls and scales of bad deeds, may Allah forbid. And sometimes death is the best thing that could ever happen to a person. It rushes him to the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal and ends for him the hardships of this life. Oh Allah, grant me life so long as life is good for me, and put me to death when you know that death is better for me. The khayr. So Musa alayhi salam said, Oh Allah, grant me whatever khayr you know, I am in dire need of it. Also, what we learn from the wording of this dua is that Musa alayhi salam spoke in general terms. And some of the scholars mention that this is proper manners with Allah, that especially when you're speaking about dunya, you speak in general terms, because you need Allah for everything. But it is unbefitting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, according to some of the scholars, to mention your needs in detail. They say that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to us, you ask Allah for everything that you need, even the strap of your shoe, it doesn't actually mean, oh Allah, grant me a shoe strap, right? What it means is, oh Allah, I need from you everything. But I ask of you in general, and you open the floodgates for me. So in the manners of dua, according to some of the ulama, they say that a person should intend the dunya without mentioning it. Without mentioning it, meaning in its detail. And for example, here that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us to say, رَبَّنَا آتِينَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً. Oh Allah, grant us the good of this life. وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. And give us the good of the next life and protect us from the punishment of the fire. The good of this life is known. It's mentioned simply and in brief. And then the second part is, well, and grant us the good of the next and protect us from the punishment of the fire. The good of the next includes being protected from the punishment of the fire. But the matters of the hereafter are more important and more grand, so we mention them in greater detail as part of saying, this is greater importance to us, this is of greater value in our eyes, but still we ask Allah for the dunya and the akhirah. So he said, oh Allah, I am in a dire need of whatever good you can send to me. Then the verses continue and say, فَجَاءَتْهُ إِحْدَاهُمَا تَمْشِي عَلَى اسْتِحْيَاءِ. So one of them, those two women, came back to him, walking upon shame or shyness or modesty. قَالَتْ إِنَّ أَبِي يَدْعُوكَ لِيَجْزِيَكَ أَجْرَ مَا سَقَيْتَ لَنَا. Our father is inviting you to reward you for what you had granted us. فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُ وَقَصَّ عَلَيْهِ الْقَصَصِ قَالَ لَا تَخَفْ نَجَوْتَ مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ. So then when he, meaning Musa alayhi salam, came to him, to their father, and he relayed to him the qasas, the stories, and this is Surah Al-Qasas, right? And relayed to him the stories, meaning of the events that happened in Egypt, he said to him, لا تخف, do not fear, نجوت من القوم الظالمين. You have been saved, you've escaped the wrongdoing people. Of course, what we learned from that is that the oppression of Fir'aun was known far and wide, that even people beyond his lands knew of him. And at the same time, he told him, don't worry, you've exited his lands here. So Musa alayhi salam was so, he did not even know, is he beyond the territories of Fir'aun yet or not? He told him, do not fear, you have escaped the wrongdoing people. He wouldn't say that if he was still in Egypt, who is this elderly man who could not work for himself to protect Musa alayhi salam from Fir'aun in his country. So he's telling him, you are beyond that now. I mean, Musa alayhi salam didn't even know. Also take from this ayah, the immediacy of the response in dua, that he said, oh Allah, I'm in dire need of whatever good you send my way. So one of them came walking up to him, my father is inviting you. Immediacy in the response of dua, never underestimate the power of dua. This is a man that was shoeless and jobless, and he gets a job immediately. And you will see now that he will be married off more than he ever expected. The Mufassirun mention, why did the girl come back to him so fast? Because she went back with the water and she was finished, as Ibn Kathir mentions. So her father wondered, why are you back early? How in the world did you finish this job? It takes longer, and your women, how could you finish so early? She explained to him the events. She told to him the story. So he said to her, go back and get this man so we may repay him. So he sent her out of the home again to do another job. And this also teaches you that the importance of a person being chivalrous, being manly, is just as important as him going out and earning a living. Meaning, earning a living is one way to be manly, and at the same time, a person not just allowing anyone to serve him without repaying them and trying their best to appreciate them is part of being manly. The proof of that is that he sent her out of the house again. And we said the woman leaves the house for a need. Her father saw it a need that she go get this man so that we can repay him for what he did and reward him for his efforts. And then there are two ways to recite these ayat, as the scholars mentioned. فَجَاءَتْهُ إِحْدَاهُمَا تَمْشِي عَلَى اسْتِحْيَاءٍ قَالَتْ إِنَّ أَبِي يَدْعُو. She came to him walking upon modesty, saying, my father invites you. So she came to him walking upon modesty. So this means that she was walking on it, meaning the way she walked was modest. But there's no punctuation in Arabic, and the brilliance of the order in the Quran allows for it to give an additional meaning. And that is, so she came to him walking, comma, upon modesty, she said, meaning the way she spoke was modest as well. So the way she walked and the way she talked was modest, meaning she was an emblem of haya, of modesty, And after the break, inshallah, Azza wa Jal, we talk a little bit more about that very point. Stay with us, inshallah.
لبيك اللهم لبيك
لبيك اللهم لبيك
لبيك لا شريك لك
لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك
إن الحمد
إن الحمد
والنعمة
والنعمة
لك والملك
لك والملك لا شريك لك.
A friendly message by Dr. Zakir. Win over your enemy.
In this age of hatred and animosity, our all-loving Creator has prescribed the formula for winning over your enemy. In the glorious Quran, in Surah Fusilat, chapter 41, verse number 34. Nor can goodness and evil be equal. Repel evil with what is better. You will see that he with whom you had enmity will become your close friend. Do not defeat your enemies, but rather win them over, win their hearts, and win their minds.
Beats TV, the solution for humanity. Students of Islamic International School showcase on eve of the IIS Annual Day event.
Welcome you to the grand finale of the Islamic International School.
Assalamualaikum
warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Performances par excellence, recitations soul stirring.
Man finds means for momentary pleasure when I am with him and goes astray.
They are the enemy, so beware of them.
This is the summary of our carried on expenses this month.
And don't you forget who's the boss. Oh,
yeah? Watch these cool kids impress and uplift your hearts, your minds, and your iman.
With Allah's help, this will be a memorable event.
Wiz Kids, next on Peace TV.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه وبعد. We're back to discussing the immediacy of the dua resulting in her coming to him upon modesty she walked. And she walked and then upon modesty she said. Two recitations that give two angles of meaning. That the way she walked was modest, the way she appeared was modest, and the way she spoke as well was modest. It was confirmed about Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, she was not an outgoing woman. And she came to him like this, covering her face from him. And she said to him, my father invites you. And that, by the way, is of the proofs that al-niqab is part of Islam. That al-niqab, the part of the hijab, the woman wears her veil covering her face, this is a part of Islam. Because there are people nowadays, unfortunately, that say this is not a part of our religion. There are even people that say that this is forbidden in our religion because it was taken from another religion. Rather, this is a part of Islam, and this was what the wives of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wore, and it was known to the prophets and their times before us. The scholars differ on whether it's an obligation or not, but that doesn't mean that it's possibly not from Islam. No, they all agree that it is at least recommended and definitely praiseworthy. There is no disagreement amongst the early scholars of Islam on this point, that it is a religious matter, not a customary matter. It is religious and it is praiseworthy, it is mustahab at least. And some of them even go beyond that and say, it is not just mustahab, it is even fard, it is even an obligation, and we'll leave that to the discussion of the fuqaha, the jurists. But the point is, this is from Islam, and this is of the proof that it's from haya, it is from shame and modesty, and it is recommended and rewardable for that. She came upon modesty. Umar said, her face was covered, and she spoke with modesty. She said what? Inna abi yad'u, my father invites you. Notice her choice of words. My father invites you, not come over to our house, we want to reward you. Come over, have a meal with us because you granted us drink, so we're going to grant you food. No, my father invited you to reward you for the water that you granted us. And then he came to him. He came to that elderly man, the father of those two girls, and he relayed to him the stories. وَقَصَّ عَلَيْهِ الْقَصَصِ And he relayed to him the stories. قَالَ لَا تَخَفْ He said, don't fear. نَجَوْتَ مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ You have been protected from the wrongdoing people. Who is this elderly man? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say, and I seek protection in you from knowledge which does not benefit. So it does not benefit to know who he was as an individual, or else Allah azza would have clarified it. It's just like the verse how it begins. and a woman came walking upon modesty, or walking and upon modesty, she said, Allah mentioned that her quality was a quality of modesty. He mentioned it because it's important to us. That's her most important quality. Many people went off to say what were their names, and we start investigating the historical reports. There is not much benefit in what her name is, or else Allah Azza wa Jalla have mentioned it to us. This is the beauty of our Quran. It gives us what will benefit and warns us from what will harm, and that's it. So we learn from the Quran by what it mentions to us and when it does not mention to us. It withholds from us what is a waste of memory up here and could preoccupy us in the big picture. Don't you know that some people have had conferences to debate, non-Muslims, had debates on what kind of tree it was that Adam alayhi salam ate from? What in the world? What is the benefit in that? Alhamdulillah, we are not of those that are al-dalleen, those that are lost, have no idea what to focus on and what to take from and what to leave. The Quran teaches us by what it tells us and teaches us by what it withholds from us. Know that this girl, she was upon haya. That's her most important quality. As to her name is not very important. What's important is to have her quality. So he came and told him the story, and the man said to him, لا تخف, don't be afraid. نجوت من القوم الظالمين. The verses continue to say that the girl told her father, oh my father, repay him and adopt his services, hire him. قالت إحداهما, Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying this next verse, Surah Al-Qasas, we're continuing now. One of the two of them said, oh my father, استأجره, hire him. إن خير من استأجرت القوي الأمين. Indeed, the best one that you can hire is someone that is strong and someone that is trustworthy. It was reported about Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an, and Ibn Abbas and others, that her father asked her, and how do you know that he is strong and trustworthy? So she said to him, I recognize his strength because he was able to lift the boulder from by the well, a boulder that 10 men couldn't carry. That was obvious that he was strong. She says, and as for his trustworthiness, when you told me to bring him, he said to me, no, you walk behind me. And when I take a wrong route, throw a rock in the other direction so I know which way to go. Meaning he went out of his way to protect himself from slipping from the default and the rule of lowering the gaze. So we knew that this was a righteous person, a virtuous person, someone who is trustworthy, someone who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala an, he said, أَفْرَسُ النَّاسِ ثَلَاثَ, the people with the most firasa. Firasa is that intuition. You know, when you have a sense for things, even a non-Muslim could have firasa, but the firasa of the believer is not comparable. They say it's like the difference between the sun and a candle. A person can have a knack for things. A businessman is so adept at analyzing business schemes, he'll say, leave it. But what's wrong with it? Trust me, just leave it. It's going to fail. You're going to waste your money. He just has a knack for it. This is firasa, intuition. He says the people with the strongest intuition ever were three. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, when he chose Umar ibn al-Khattab and insisted that he be the Khalifa, he placed him there as the Khalifa before he died. He said, and in the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, he said, عَسَىٰ أَنْ يَنْفَعَنَا, when they took Yusuf alayhi salam and no one knew who he was, but he said, perhaps he will be of benefit for us. And he had no idea how much Yusuf alayhi salam would benefit him. And he said, and the daughter of this man, when she said, oh my father, hire him, the most qualified person to hire is al-qawiyyu al-amin, someone who is of strength and someone who is of trustworthiness. And these are the qualities of leadership. These are the most necessary qualities in a good leader, that he is strong, meaning he knows how to do and he's capable of doing. He's qualified, as they say in the business world. He has the qualifications. And he is amin and he is trustworthy. Because what's the point of being capable if you're not trustworthy and you're going to use your abilities against, right, the objective that is sought? And that's why Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu used to complain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he did not know who to appoint as a leader. He could not find sufficient leadership to place as governors in his time. And he used to say, Allahumma inni ashku ilayka jalad al-fajir wa ajza al-thiqa. Oh Allah, I complain to you. Umar al-Khattab was al-Qawiyyul Amin as well. But he said, I complain to you that I cannot find, I complain to you the toughness of the corrupt person, the toughness of the wicked, and the inability of the trustworthy. Meaning I can't find someone who is tough and strong and capable to do things right and can be trusted. I find one quality or the other, but I can't find both. And so she said to him, oh my father, hire him. Indeed, the best person you can hire is someone who is trustworthy and someone who is strong. And she recognized from him, from very subtle decisions that he made and very subtle actions that he did, that he was indeed strong and he was indeed trustworthy, and he definitely was that. And of course, what we learn from these ayat is the mannerism in speaking to our parents. She said, Ya Abati, O my father, O my respected father, addressing him by his title. And this is of the respect that is due to our parent that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to teach. And Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu would say, what he learned from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of course, is your father's right, is that you not call him by his name, and that you not walk in front of him, and you not sit before him, as if they are royalty. This is of the mannerisms that she had, and was exemplified towards her father. And also what we learn here, you can't help but notice already, this is the fourth amazing woman we're talking about. Musa alayhi salam's mother, the wife of Fir'aun, Musa alayhi salam's sister, and now this woman, the daughter of this righteous man. It is silly to those that read the Quran to accept the notion, that Islam undermines women and oppresses women. And a person is subject to that notion, despite it being so preposterous, so nonsensical, when they don't read the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was a small plug that we had to put, because the issue of that accusation, Islam oppresses women, and Islam considers a woman a second-hand citizen, a person who has not read the Quran, they need to be informed. The non-Muslims we're talking about. But when a Muslim who believes that the Quran is the words of Allah and doesn't know his book well enough, he can see now and notice how susceptible he could be to something so ridiculous. So be careful and read the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the armor of your heart. Protect your heart from these whispers of shaitan and those that work on behalf of shaitan by reading the book of Allah azza wa jal. Look, four women already, examples for us in so many different lights. And so we move on to the next ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَالَ, he said, meaning the father now took the advice of the young girl from his humility, and he said, إِنِّي أُرِيدُ أَنْ أُنْكِحَكَ إِحْدَى بْنَتَيَّ هَاتَيْنِ, I wish to marry you to one of these two daughters of mine. عَلَى أَنْ تَأْجُرَنِي ثَمَانِيَ حِجَجٍ, in exchange that you allow yourself to be employed by me, for me to hire you for 8 years. فَإِنْ أَتْمَمْتَ عَشْرًا فَمِنْ عِنْدِكَ, and if you complete 10 years, that's from you. Meaning that's up to you. I'm not going to obligate you with all 10. وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ أَشُقَّ عَلَيْكَ, and I'm not going to overburden you. It's not going to be a job that is beyond your capacity. سَتَجِدُونِي إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ, you will find me إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ of those that are righteous. So he went to Musa alayhi salam and told him, I want to marry you to one of my daughters, to one of these two daughters of mine, in exchange that you work for me for 8 years, and if you can, for 10. And I'm not going to overburden you with the workload, and you will find that I am true to this, that I am of the righteous. Many beautiful lessons here. The first lesson is that the father went to Musa alayhi salam and he told him, marry my daughter, right? And of course, Musa alayhi salam would have married one of the two daughters and it would have been designated, because as we know that a person cannot have a contract, a sales contract or a marriage contract, considered contract, of the reasons why that they have to be clear. You can't say, I marry your daughter, and the man could have many daughters and then we don't know who he's really married to. You can imagine what would consequence from that. And thus, it's of the conditions of the marriage contract that it be clear who exactly he's marrying. Just wish to mention that. I wish to marry you to one of my two daughters in exchange for you servicing me, allowing me to benefit from your services, me hiring you for 8 years. So Musa alayhi salam would be hired. This is the deal. And he would receive food and drink. Obviously, he would have a job and he would be married to this woman. A very quick lesson here as well, that a person is allowed to marry in Islam for worldly reasons. Because when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a person chooses his wife, Bukhari and Muslim, the hadith, you know it, for her wealth or for her status or for her beauty or for her deen, and choose the woman of deen so that you may be successful, so that you don't fail. This does not mean that you can't have a woman of deen and a woman of wealth, right? That would be better than a woman that just has deen, because she would be charitable till the end of this. Just because she's a woman of deen doesn't mean a woman of deen and beauty wouldn't be even better. Not to be idealistic, but at the same time to not be limited in your understanding. Thus I mention it. In exchange for you working for me, you'll have a job as well. So he married for this reason. At the same time, this does not mean that this was the dowry that is acceptable in Islam, in the sense that you service the father to get married to the daughter. And of also what has to be mentioned here as well, is that the father must have understood that his daughter would be willing to marry this man, because of the conditions of the marriage contract is the approval of the girl. So there's nothing wrong with a man going for his daughter and saying, come, you will marry my daughter, right? And then he says, do you approve? If she approves, it's fine. But if she does not approve, she has the right to annul the contract. It's like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did with Al-Khansa. She said, my father married without my consent. So he told her, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the marriage would be null and void. She said, no, Messenger of Allah, I accept. I just wanted the women to know that they have a right regarding the matter. So the issue of forced marriages is not allowed. Arranged marriages, meaning the advice of your father, this is fine. He arranges it, meaning he sets it up, he advises, he counsels, he goes out and looks for you, that's great. Rather, this is praiseworthy. The wise man is the one that goes out and looks for his daughter, and we'll mention why when we have more time, as time has run out and separated between us again. We hope that Allah Azza wa Jal will gather us upon the best of terms in this world and the next. In the next episode, inshallah Azza wa Jal, we'll speak about the wisdom of a father that goes out looking for his daughter, a righteous husband. Jazakallahu khairan wa sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
He created the universe.